Good evening, residents of the town of Sunderland. It is Tuesday, May 17th, right?
Yep.
It is 6:30. We are back to interviewing chief of police candidates. Some of you may wonder why we do it over three nights. One time we had, a while back, we had a town administrator before Sherry search, and we did them all on a Saturday. And we started like at 10 o'clock, and the time to get done was 5, 6 o'clock.
5 o'clock.
We were exhausted.
Yeah.
And I don't know if I heard the last candidate or two. So we always decide we would never do that again. But it is a way to do it. It just didn't work for us that time. Although I'm sure asking questions of chief of police is much more exciting than a town administrator, because town administrator is boring stuff. Right, Sherry? And matter of fact, at the end of our interviews, we had a question for Sherry that she didn't answer during her interviews, and she has promised that she will have an answer for us.
She tried last night.
You know that question, right?
Before I retire.
There you go. You know what you can do is hand it in when you hand in your notice.
That's right.
Oh, by the way, here's the answer.
Oh, yeah.
So, tonight is round two. We have a candidate from out in the more central area. In the Barry area, right?
Yes, Barry.
And some people out here would call that Eastern Mass, but if you're out there, you'd probably call it Central Mass.
Central Mass. Correct.
Barry has some nice things, including the Quabog Corporation that makes the soles for the...
North Brookfield has that.
That's right, North Brookfield, right? The soles for...
the rubber.
Yeah, they make rolls. I mean, the soles. So we have this evening... And I know why Scott chose not to be chair this time. But when you have a great town administrator, she practices with you all day long on how to pronounce a last name. And we have Eric Demetropoulos.
Perfect.
This evening. Well, of course, Sherry would
have this wrong.
And Eric has been a chief for many years, 10 years. Also served as the president of the Central Mass Chief of Police Association. So what we're going to do tonight, Chief, is we'll start the questions with Scott. This is the time to sell yourself.
Okay.
Don't worry about the TV. I mean, we are the number one rated program in Sunderland.
Outstanding.
But I don't think we interrupted polka time, so we should get a lot. We should get a high volume.
Okay, great.
Tonight should be good.
So, Mr. Bertrand, you ready?
I am, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Pierce, are you ready?
Let it rip.
Let's go. I will start with Mr. Bertrand. Have at it, my friend.
Thank you, sir. I am taking a cue from reporters' comments last night. I'm starting actually on page 3. I want to ask if I could. First of all, thanks so much. I appreciate not only the application, but all the good things you said about the screening committee. They're a tough nut to crack, but, you know, you made it here, and I'm very appreciative of you not only applying, but taking the time.
Great. Thank you.
That said, having chief's experience, gone through the level of services that you have, why are you interested in this role in this town?
Well, I grew up in the town of Barry. Since the early 70s and watched it flourish to the mega metropolis that it is now of 5,000 people. And I remember as a child growing up and as a young adult and seeing the way the town was back in the 70s and 80s and in the lower, smaller population. So I've always enjoyed being in a small town, and I believe I've done a great job. I know that some of the people in town will agree with me. And when I started looking around for other employees, I saw that Sunderland had come up and saw that it's a just over 3,000 population. Beautiful when you drive through it. It's just amazing with what you guys have in this town. I love the elementary school and not having a regional school in the town either. My youngest daughter is going to graduate from sixth grade, so I've been dealing with a regional school district and the issues sometimes that may come up traffic, some of the other call volumes. And I don't foresee that happening too much with an elementary school as you would with a high school. That being said, obviously, we've responded and assisted in other departments in other towns for whatever various calls they have. But I thoroughly enjoyed working in Barry, and I see Sunderland has the same qualities and the same things to offer in a small town.
Thanks so much. Very good follow-up, Mr. Chair.
Judge Carney.
We have, in the town of Sunderland, had over 12 years or so, and Bruce can probably help out, progressive, steady growth, but not like significant developments, large housing projects, etc. What part of that growth in Barrie has you out looking around?
What part of the growth?
Yeah. Because you mentioned in your answer, you know, I kind of remember Barry having grown up there. I grew up in the town of Southampton.
Oh, okay.
And so I know. I grew up on that dirt road that now is, you know, that has a school on it. And you know, mom's going to class every morning, yeah, driving 55 miles an hour with, yeah, her coffee cups, not looking around, you know, all that stuff. Oh, yeah. I see it every day. That said, and that was a stereotype, and I'm happy to reinforce it with video in case anybody wants to watch every given morning. But I know the growth part. I'm just curious about your thoughts.
Well, I really enjoyed growing up in Barrie, mm-hmm, and so much so that I moved back after the Marine, right, Corps and bring my family up. And Barrie hasn't grown to a point where I'm throwing my hands up and saying, okay, Barrie's too big and I have to go away. That's not exactly what's happening. But when you can take another town, and you have a pretty robust throughway through here. I mean,
oh, yeah,
our biggest one is 122. And
yeah, we got some hustle through town.
122 isn't even, it's not maybe bike friendly, but it's pedestrian friendly either. But, you know, 116 and 47 and, yep, 63 cuts through another section,
yeah,
I think.
Just up here.
Oh, yeah. Up top. Yeah. All right. So you have a lot of people going through, but the culture within Sunderland, I just, from what I've seen in either news reports, what I've seen online, I've got some friends in Western Mass, but what I call Western Mass, and it just really seemed like a nice fit, and I really thought that one might be something interesting, especially with my youngest now moving up to middle school age. It's just a perfect time in my life to pick up and call another place home.
Great. Thanks so much. I appreciate the follow-up. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
David?
All right. I'm going to just call out the question number so we can check them off, so we make, mm-hmm, sure we get them all. This is number 3. Based on your knowledge of our town and its demographics, identify the program areas you'd focus on and describe how you would intend to undertake the tasks of a new chief during your first 6 months on the job. Kind of like, what's your sort of game plan for when you step in there? And
okay. Well, the biggest demographic I've always been one to go after are the children. So I think I would have a little bit of an advantage in the summer because school's out. So it gives me some months to get things ready. But the elementary school, there really has to be a great partnership with law enforcement, with its police department in the school, and not just with the teachers, but with the kids, and then the understanding with parents and everything else. So there's a lot of things I would like to try to introduce to the school, not so much as forcing ourselves on them, but having a great relationship, meeting with the principal, meeting with the different staff, go over again any type of emergency plans that may or may not be in place, and then meeting with the staff to determine what areas we can bring into the classroom if the school is so willing to do so. I'm sure there are officers on the department that have a wide basis of knowledge with a lot of different topics that could bring this information to the school, and I think that building that environment with the kids speaks volumes. Because when I was a DARE officer in the elementary school in Barrie, I had dealt with the kids from elementary all the way up when I see them in juniors and seniors in high school, and then even now some of them were involved in the youth group that I used to lead. I still lead, but they're now graduated with the local church and get involved with the kids that way. So I think that's one thing that we definitely want to build upon. obviously, you can't do that without buy-in with your own staff, so you have to sit down with the officers of the police department and the command structure and determine what have they done, what's worked, what hasn't worked. Where do they see the police department going, and what do they want the reaction to be? I'm sure a lot of the staff love Sunderland and want to be able to make the community, make them part of the community, instead of people looking at the officers as just enforcing the law and not Jim or John or Eric. It's, oh, I know, you know, this officer. It's not just, you know, that's the guy that gave me a ticket, or that's the guy that did this. So building a lot of relationship with the school and with the staff.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. And I have to warn you, I told the committee before, I can talk a dog off a meat wagon, so if...
That's all right.
If I'm talking too much, just, you know, snap at me and I'll stop.
Well, actually, I'm not done with that, Chief.
Okay.
If, you know, you talked that you'd like to talk with the schools, you'd like to talk with the staff, but if there's three people in town that you'd have, like to get to know, who would they be?
Well, I think the first person I'm going to be dealing a lot with would be the town administrator. So that's going to have to be first. Have to build a relationship with the town administrator and have an understanding. What does she expect? Where do we go from there? And then what do I need to bring to the table for that? And I kind of use that as a umbrella because obviously the town administrator would be a window to the select board. The next person I'd want to sit down with is somebody involved in the school, because I know you have an elementary school. I'd want to sit down with the principal or the vice principal or whoever is available to meet and go over those topics. And then the next aspect, or the next person, I believe, would have to be, and I'm at a disadvantage because I don't know a lot of the names that go with some of the people, but what I did in Barry is I also met with a business owner. Somebody who has, and I just randomly picked it. I didn't pick somebody that I knew. And growing up in Barry, I did know a lot of people, so I had to randomly pick it. But you want to find out, what does the business aspect of the community want from the police department? And were there any issues that weren't addressed? Or were the issues that were addressed, how were they addressed, and were they enjoyed by them? And then maybe we can build on that.
Thank you, Chief. Any others follow?
No, that was good.
Chief, please describe three specific accomplishments in your local government law enforcement career that you consider to be the most significant.
The most recent was I was able to secure $3 million from the State House. And now that's a huge undertaking, but I was able to sit down with our longstanding senator. Before that, he was our state rep and a local selectman. And he was able to secure us $3 million to build or begin to build a public safety building. So we're looking at groundbreaking sometime, I believe, first couple weeks of June. And this is huge because the police department moved to the current town hall. It's the Henry Woods building.
Is that right in the center of town? Like just before you get to the center, when you're coming in from the west? You're coming
yes.
from the west, yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
So right on West Street, 122. So they moved us temporarily after the fire in 1980. So 35 years later, we're still there, and it was.
Have we heard that before?
It's temporary. I'm sure it doesn't happen in other towns, but you know, and we grew. When I was a child, growing up in town, and as I got on to the older years, I was able to drive. Everyone knew the town hall. Where it was, and then after the fire, they moved to the Henry Woods building. And I remember going there as a kid and seeing the little corner of the dispatch center, and then seeing where it is now. We've basically taken over half of the first floor, but even then, we're busting at the seams. So having this money and be able to go and build a partnership with one of the private schools, get 4.017 acres of land, and we're going to start the public safety building there. So that's the most recent one. Another accomplishment that I hold dear to myself was the rise in the ranks through the Central Mass Chiefs. I began at the Sergeant at Arms and worked up to the President of Central Mass Chiefs. My tenure with them, with the presidency, ended the first of this year. So I'm kind of the ex officio now. I don't have to go to the meetings, but I still do. It's in great hands now with the Sutton Police Chief. I really enjoyed that process. I was able to get in touch with a lot of legislators, other chiefs that I probably never would have spoken to, not because I'm a bad guy or they're a bad guy, or it was because their geography. There's no reason for me to go visit Bellingham. Great guy, but there's no reason to go visit him. But this was a great interaction, and then it built up my involvement with the statewide mass chiefs. I don't hold any offices at that point, and I'm sure my wife would be happy. I don't hold any more offices because of all the other non-duty, off-duty times you had to go to different meetings and whatnot. So that was another event in my life that I felt was proud for me. I was able to attain that. It's a non-paid position. It was all about being part of the greater good and working with law enforcement across the state. That was number two. The third one was something that happened a few years ago. I was involved, as many police officers are, in day-to-day work. And this one time I was off duty, and one thing that we always talk about in law enforcement, about stressors and de-stressors, and try to take things, get your mind off the job and enjoy time with the family. I was awoken by my youngest a few years back, and it was Father's Day. So they wanted to take me somewhere and go somewhere and do something, and we ended up going to a beach in the town of Rutland. And while there, there was some commotion, and it turns out a young boy had drowned in the water. And, you know, initially when I heard this, you know, screaming and whose kid is this, I, as a dad, I thought, oh, some kid just got in trouble. You know, some mom pulled him by the ear. And I look over and I see this boy being held by somebody who I later found out to be his father. And I knew instantly he wasn't doing well. Went over, left where I was, and began working on him. And he came back to life. He was blue, pale, just, you could tell by looking at him. And I've dealt with, unfortunately, and any police officer has dealt with it, a lot of difficult scenes to deal with. It wasn't that event that is an accomplishment with me. It was the building of the relationship I have with him and his family now. They're from Springfield. I see him a few times a year. Usually at cheer sessions. My youngest daughter's in cheerleading, so I was able to build a relationship with him and his family, and I really take that to heart. I'm really happy to see that, because he is just so full of life now, and just so full of just everything that you remembered as young little boys would be. And in the back of my head, I always think about, you know, what if I had chosen a different place to go? Would someone have stepped up? And I truly believe someone would have stepped up, but someone put me there, a greater being, if you will, put me there and said, you know, you're going to be there for him. So I hold that as another one.
Chief, can I have a follow-up question on that?
Please.
This one may be a tough one. You said something very interesting about the importance of time off, especially in a police officer, because of the magnitude or the multitude of things that they may see or do. Question is, what happens if you have you're short of staff, you have an officer that you know just had a very bad day, you have no one to cover that shift, he needs to go home, what do you do?
Well, first and foremost, you have to send him home, whether it's to his family, to friends, to counseling, whatever, they have to go. They have to be able to have that, and you find a way. If you're short-staffed, then those who are salary step up and they go to work. Simple as that. If you have a sudden infant death syndrome, you have usually a young child when you're dealing with the little kids, it affects anybody so much that you want them to have that time to really understand what they just went through. And I don't want to call it you order them go home, but you send them home. And then you make do, you find a way. Now, we work in the public, so you have public funds, you can't overspend, you can't really go crazy with that. So you have to find a way to make that work. And if it means that those who are salary stay or come in, then so be it. I know in Barry, while it's frowned upon by some departments, our full-time officers, when they work, there's a relationship where it's not always about the money. Some of the guys and girls will work regardless because it's going to help Joe or Steve or Karen. It's going to help them. They're going to do it because it's a family. Some of them understand the fiscal issues and will say to you, I'll work this for comp time. If I know you can't pay me, but if I work these extra 4 hours, can I have an extra 4 hours off down the road? And that might be something where you can get filled. And that's something that, if that's a relationship you've got to do, then that's something you got to do. You got to think outside the box. It can't always be strict, you know. I'm sorry you had a tough day, but stick it out and I'll see you tomorrow at 7. You know, you have to understand that there's a human aspect to it.
Thank you, Chief.
Yep.
Scotty?
I'm going to change gears if I could, Chief, and circle back around toward community policing. If you wouldn't mind taking time to explain your approach to not only promoting, but what maybe you have accomplished inside of community policing, and then throughout the aspects of the department. The chief's view of community policing might be more policy, but, you know, implementation benefits.
Sure. Okay, well, community policing has always been the buzzword in law enforcement. You know, it's because they were throwing money at it. You know, you have the community policing grant. So, of course, everyone knows that terminology because there was money tied to it. But we've grown, and in Massachusetts especially, when you look across nationwide, Massachusetts is pretty well liked by the general public. Some states don't have that relationship. And I think it's because of community policing and not the grant-funded one. It's the, okay, you have a department of 8, 10, 20, 30, 400 officers. You find out, whether you find out or your supervisors find out, where are these officers best in the community? Maybe one officer really loves teaching or being involved with the school, but he's working midnights. So how can you get him to be involved with the community more? Can he do some of the school meetings? Can he do some of the dances? Can he do, you know, I don't mean him dancing, but, you know, at the dances for the kids.
You're a good dancer.
Well, speaking as of someone who was not a good dancer, then that's fine. But you want to get them involved with their strengths. You find out how are they involved with the community. Every year we're part of the teddy bear picnic. And I know you're envisioning me right now with my uniform holding a teddy bear. There are pictures online. You can see those. But I was even standing next to Superman last year. But we do this every year in August. It's a quick 6-7 hours in the day. Yeah, you go in, you get the cars ready, make them look nice, you bring them down. It's like a mini safety day, and the kids love it. You pass out coloring books, you pass out stickers, you let them get in the cruiser and hit the siren and the lights and wear your hat or something. Not because you want to build, you know, some fake persona of yourself. You're doing it because you actually care about the community you live in, and you want these kids to see you as somebody that is not the, you know, if you don't put your seatbelt on, that officer's going to lock you up type thing. You want them to see you as a good person. But then build on that. You know, I when the community policing grants got cut, it was a tough blow to a lot of departments. There were other grants that you can kind of work your way around it towards community policing. But unfortunately, yeah, town government and town police departments are governed by taxpayers' money. If you don't have the money, then you might not be able to do A, B, C, and D. We did something through a grant that I didn't think the residents would really take a liking to. But I found it was $11,600 through state funding that we ended up putting out there. And a portion of that, I want to say $4,000 or $5,000 of that, was for patrols, bike patrols. A couple of officers on mountain bikes. I know you're like that, but it's on mountain bikes, but it wasn't anything big, but they're driving through the neighborhoods, going through the campgrounds. They weren't patrolling the streets by any means. We have 106 miles of road. I don't care who you are, but if you get a hot call, you're not going to pedal your bike down the street to get to a call when there's a perfectly good cruiser sitting right there. But just, you were concentrating on being part of the public, and they loved it. And then the following year, when we didn't have the funding for it, I got a ration for it. Where did that go? Why did you take that away? I didn't take it away. We still have the bikes. Let me show you. But with a lot of things in Mass, you have to have certifications. So some of the officers had gone to other departments. So we've only got a handful of officers now. We have three bikes. We have a handful of officers now that are certified. We're going to hopefully get some more through the state training. But something like that, something that I never even thought of would be a huge thing. And I grew up in town. I rode those streets on mountain bikes, running around, cutting through the old railroad bed to come around to the other side to avoid the traffic. And now the officers are doing it, and it's something that was really big. So that's something we definitely want to bring back. Another thing was some local residents saw this, I forget exactly where, but they went out with their own money and purchased tickets, little gift cards or whatnot, and came to me and said, we want you to pass these out. We want you to give tickets to the kids wearing helmets.
Yep.
Great idea. The only unfortunate thing was when we first started the program, it was only one vendor. So the kids in the south part of town had to tell their parents to drive them 6 miles to the vendor up in the center. And the parents really weren't liking that too much. So when we brought it back the second year, we had a couple other different organizations buy into it, and they were able to do that. We have a lady now in town who just started this program again and got the other companies to work and get involved. And the officers are, you know, we're going to be getting, they're going to be getting their tickets in the next couple of weeks because the great weather's out. The kids are going to be getting out of school soon, and they can go ahead and pass out tickets. I did get pulled aside by one of the parents and said, listen, this kid, you have to get him the ticket because I don't care if it's winter. I don't care if it's, he's, whenever he can ride that bike, he's out there and he's got his helmet on. So you have to reward him. So it's been our goal to find this one kid. Every time I see him in his school, so he's not walking around with his helmet. But so a lot of that's been a buy-in, and it's a relationship that you have that getting these ideas from outside that really come in. Now, I tell you all that, and the chief may want to do a program like that, but again, you've got to go back to the buy-in of the department. You have to find out what have they done in the past that they've enjoyed. What did they go through that said, you know, this was a hit and a, you know, this was a miss. There was no way you were going to get anything with this, or what are their strengths, and then build on that and then go forward. Because if they see that you support this and you're going forward with it, you're going to see them flourish and then really going to get involved with it.
Okay, Mr. Chair, same follow-up as last night.
I had a follow-up last night about grants in general. And grants, in this case here, you described what I'm hearing is a description of grants that created initiative that may have amended or adapted the existing culture. Mm-hmm. Do you think that's a correct statement?
Yes.
Pretty close?
Yeah.
I mean, some grants we know are grants, and they kind of wither on the vine, but once they're done, that initiative is complete.
True.
And what you're describing is very, very different.
What I'm describing is it is different because you have to have the buy-in, obviously, from the members, but then with town government, because it's a small mini grant I get every year. It's $500.
Yeah.
You know, what are you going to buy, or what are you going to get for $500?
Sure.
Well, you'd be surprised. One year, we gave it to an after-school program, mm-hmm. that was able to get water bottles with logos on it to talk about kids about making good choices and good decisions. That sticks with them for a few years, especially if they're going to seventh grade and they're going to be taking part in the high school and middle school sports. And they have that. And subliminally, they're seeing, oh, I remember this program. I was part of this program. Oh, yeah, the police department worked with us on that. To another time, another year, we did something with the library. And we did casts of footprints, and we had like a little mini mock crime scene where the kids get to figure out who the suspect was. Ended up being the library director, so but she loved it, and the kids loved it.
That's why we checked too.
Exactly. And then this year, I just got it again. I think this is my fourth or fifth year, but this year I got it again, and I'm actually I haven't made it public yet, but I'm going to get it to a program that actually encompasses a lot more of the region instead of just Barry. There's a group called the Quabbin Bulldogs. It's this peewee football cheerleading program. So the boys and the girls, doesn't matter, you can be on either team. They hit some hard times, and I remember when I was a DARE officer about 17 years ago, the chief had a community policing grant, and some of that money would go to that program because it kept kids in a program other than running around the neighborhoods doing nothing.
Yeah.
And it was great because I don't know if any of you know any peewee football coaches. I've met them, at least the ones that we have in our area, and I tell you, they could take care of the high school like that. They're on point with these kids. They run them into the ground. So when they get home, it's, okay, mental note, homework before I go, because when I get home, I'm going right to bed, because there is nothing to do afterwards. And they're disciplined, and there's rules and regulations, and they're getting the kids involved. So that type of program, getting involved with the kids, and again, I keep going back to the kids, but, I mean, you have to. You have to have a program where they can have that relationship with you. So one grant that I'm working on now is a regional school resource officer. I've been denied 3 years in a row. It's a $125,000 grant. I'm hoping year four is the key for me. And the $125,000 grant kind of places a trying to say this the right way. Kind of places a point to the selectmen, to the superintendent, to all those involved that, hey, this is the federal government. We're going to give you $125,000, but you have to pick up 10% of the officer's cost. 25% of the officer's cost. So what I was looking at was $10,000 for year one, $10,000 for year two, $10,000 for year three. Whether it's the school committee, the school, regional school, then it's dispersed to the regions, or it's the local host town, which would be Barry. And then year four, that town or that school owns the entire cost. So the other 75% is picked up by the grant for 3 years. What's great about that grant is it forces you to have a year four paid for by the school or by the police department, and it forces that school resource officer, chief, regional departments all around to have a school resource officer policy, a program, and it's not just a person in a uniform walking through the school. What type of involvement do they have? So in that type of grant perspective, yes, it's 3 years paid, fourth year you pay for it, but we want to come back and say, oh, look, it's been 10 years and you're still running. You know, so did this program, did this money help you get off the in the right track? Because my school doesn't have a school resource officer. It's 7 through 12. We have 430 middle school kids and just over 700 high school kids plus staff. There are more people in that building Monday through Friday than at least two of my towns,
right,
population. So, and I think that we need to have some type of involvement with that. And I've spoken with a lot of school resource officers that have gone through a program, and they tell me the good, the bad, the ugly, and hopefully that's something that we can get going and get the department to go with it. But that grant is great because that grant kind of forces you to say, okay, hey, you're going to give us this much money. This is great, but then we got to pick it up by year four. So capital planning, you know. In 3-4 years from now, instead of earmarking that $10,000, now you have to earmark that $40,000.
Good point. Thanks, I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Just a quick call up. Hopefully, this.
I definitely agree with what you're saying about the kids and stuff. How about a more challenging aspect? Because the kids, in some way, are easy to approach and deal with because they're kids. And but what about our town's a little different in that a large percent is rental housing. So how do you approach, yeah, like the community policing aspect of that? And also to, you know, kind of like people like our age and stuff, you don't really generally have as much contact with that demographic unless you stop them for something or, you know.
Sure.
Or, you know what I mean? Yeah. So it's a little harder, I think, to reach out to those folks in town.
Speaking from what we've done in Barry, we have a myriad of different ages. We have a older age assisted living, We have an area where it's like a housing authority. Mm-hmm. We have a trailer park on the north part of, west part of town that has 55 and over. Then after that, you have all the kids, and then you have all the young adults, the single kids. I call them kids because my oldest is 21 now, so she's still a kid. But what involvement can you do? What involvement can you have with that community? So what I did was back, I want to say 4 or 5 years, I was met by a Peabody police officer. He had this program. It was an app for a smartphone. And the town of Barry, I said, oh, they're never going to buy it. This is not going to work. But we had to have some type of communication and involvement with the public, feedback even. And I launched and I operate all the social media aspects within the police department. We have Google Plus, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and now we have the smartphone app, which works on iPhones and Androids. The great thing about the social media aspects is they're all free. It doesn't cost us a penny. It's just a matter of not policing it, but someone being involved. When someone emails through the app or someone messages you through the page or asks a question, to try to be able to provide that answer in a timely fashion. You don't want to look back and go, oh, 3 months ago, so-and-so asked a question and didn't respond. You've kind of missed the mark on that one. You want to have some type of response. And I know Sunderland has a social media presence, and that's great. That being said, you're not going to always reach out to everybody with social media. But if you can build that, like I did in Barry, you can get involved with the community. But then after that, and I mentioned to you before about getting involved with business owners, what do the officers do with the business owners? What kind of involvement do they have? How are they interacting with the business owners, customers, the certain patrols, whether it be foot patrol, bike patrol, or just stopping, getting out of the cruiser and going in and saying hi. But then, and this is something that I don't have a lot of experience in, is the rental properties. We have people who own houses, they have duplexes, and we'll deal with some landlord-neighbor disputes, but we don't have apartment complexes. Right, I've noticed you guys have a huge one right down here, that's something that, you know, is there an association? Do they have an association like a condo association? Is there like a landlord-tenant meetings do they have at all, quarterly, monthly? If so, how can we be involved in that? Even something as simple as when you interact with someone from that community, trying to get an idea from them of how they've dealt with the police department before, do some follow-up, even with the landlords. If the landlord is trying to kick somebody out, or the landlord is having one neighbor complain about the other neighbor, how can they resolve it other than draining the police resources all the time, or him or her draining their money because they have to take them to court all the time. So you have to get that involved. When I mentioned the kids, obviously you're going to get the parents because no parent's going to let anybody, regardless of whether you have a badge or not, go into the school and teach them something that you may have questions about. So you start having informational meetings with the parents. I realize that it's a marathon at this point. It's not a sprint. We have held numerous informational meetings with parents, and more people attend selectmen's meetings than they attend these informational meetings.
Actually, this is kind of packed.
This is packed, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, the last informational meeting we had at my school, and this is a regional school.
Yeah.
You've got potentially every kid in the district is what we try to reach it out to, but we were fully expecting, well, maybe just middle school and high school parents, and we only had maybe a handful or two more than we have tonight. And you can't let that take you down. You have to have perseverance. You still have to continue with it and still interact with the public in some way, and hopefully I answered your question the proper way.
Yeah, no, that's fine. And it sort of followed into the next question, which was about social media, because I noticed that you mentioned that in there, and then you covered that. So I'm going to take a little bit of a different twist on that. How, especially in a small town with limited resources, how do you see keeping up with, I know right now we essentially mostly just use Facebook.
Yeah.
How do you see sort of keeping up with that? And then what kind of downsides do you see to the use of social media? And there's all, obviously there's a lot of fantastic, you know, good aspects of it, but it can have some negative aspects too.
It can. If you use social media as just a way to inform the public and anyone else who wants to see what you're writing, then open the page, start it, and then post whenever you want, whenever you have something big, and that's fine. But you're not getting the actual, you're not grasping what it's there for law enforcement or for the community at large. The app itself that we have, the downside, it was $800 year one. Year two and beyond, it's only been $400. Because the year one, they had to build and get things done. And that's pretty pricey.
Is that even ongoing service maintenance, essentially, cost?
Yeah, it's a contract to keep the things, keep the app alive. If there's any issues, bugs, they'll fix it. You call them, they can take care of it.
What's the name of that app?
MyPD, MyPD. We jumped on a few years back, and you can just search Barry PD. And it's great because if you use your iPhone, you get on the app and say you want to know how to get to the Sunderland Police Department. If they have it, you click on directions, it closes it, opens up your GPS.
Gives you the map.
You lock it in your little device and then you just follow the GPS. It's great. But also on here, what I have found that we have a lot of use for, and I also did this as a side note on our website. Our website was very static. I used to work in computers. I look at what they do now and it floors me. From what I knew back in the 90s to what it's going on now, I give them a lot of credit for what they're doing for websites and whatnot. But our website was very static. It was just, there was really no substance. It looked beautiful, but it just really didn't have any involvement. So we changed it, and the company that we worked with out of Gardner changed it, and it's a more interactive. You can get on, you can submit tips, potholes, bullying, alcohol use, parties. You can remain anonymous or give your information, just take a photo of what you saw and then send that. And it's got pre-designated emails set up. So when you click on, say, drugs, and you put in a tip, whether it's anonymous or not, it goes specifically to those officers that are handling
the
drugs.
Behind the scenes. You get
not going to me. It's going to my supervisor and one of the officers that handle the investigations, or strictly just the supervisor, then he can disseminate it to the officers. That's great, because once you get that on board, well, for Barry, I monitor it, meaning I can add content to it. I can add links.
You're the administrator.
Buttons. I'm the administrator, so I can go and do things. So the extra, you know, $25 an hour or $75 an hour to have someone from a company do it, I remove that aspect of it.
Yeah.
But the app is great, because the app, we were able to, the following year, I was involved with the regional high school on the bullying policy. And in the bullying policy, it says, well, we have to have a way to give the kids an ability to contact somebody about cyberbullying or bullying. And I said, wait a minute, I have this app. Why don't we tie this into the bullying plan? And we posted, because, I mean, what kid, for the most part, what kid doesn't have an iPod, an iTouch, an iPhone, a Samsung, something? They can get on there, they can download the app for free, and then they can push out tips. There's smoking in the bathroom, to somebody's going and spray painting the side of the building tonight, to someone's got drugs in this spot, whether it be the school or it be in another location. Obviously, I would love it. I would love to see it used far more, but I think the amount of use we've received in the past 4 years has definitely paid for itself. It is, like I said, the financial burden is there. It's $400 a year, but I'm very proud of that, and I'm happy to have it. I can then also go in. We just had a supervisor retire, so I was able to go in and remove his contact. because I didn't want someone to go up and go, oh, this is the guy I want to talk to, and then press it, and then the email not go anywhere. So I was able to go in there and remove it instead of paying somebody else to do it. So with that, another downfall to social media is sometimes the abuse of it. I know the town of Barry started their Facebook page, and in the very beginning, they didn't want anybody to be able to comment or send private messages. Right. They just wanted it as, oh, here's something new.
Announcement
page. Oh, here's something new. And that's great. And that if that's what they wanted, because let's face it, they didn't have the abilities or the volunteer aspect to run it. If you look at the social media pages for the police department, it's become an art for me. I'm able to schedule posts ahead so I don't forget. Or when I'm at home, one of the officers will say, oh, we've got this going on, because they don't have the desire to be on there. They'll alert me, they'll send me the photo, or they'll send me a quick update about something, and then we can put that on there as an informational with the public. The other negative about the abuse is, if you're going to have a social media page, you have to allow scrutiny. You have to allow someone who disagrees with you. You have to. You can't go on there and say, oh, Jimmy Smith just said I'm a horrible person. Delete. You can't do that, because you're killing the trust and the relationship you have with the public.
Right, because it's a two-way relationship.
It's a two-way relationship. Yeah. Not to mention, it's potentially a public record violation, because you're posting this stuff on there. It's a matter of public record.
Right.
You go and delete something, you can still delete it, but you have to document why. Something that happens with us sometimes is another person has assisted me recently and has accidentally shared the post again. And what we did was we tied Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook all together.
Right,
so if I post it on Instagram, it's going to post cross-post on the other ones, which is great. Saves time. I can figure out what I'm going to put it on. And then in 5 minutes, I've now reached out to 7,000 people with one click. And then whoever else shares it from there, hundreds of thousands of people, which is great for a small 5,000 community town. I love it. So it's something like that. They accidentally reshared it, and it wanted to be some cross messages. So I screenshotted it and then deleted it. And then I put it into an email and said on the title, deleted because it was reshared too much or reshared again. But then with Facebook, I see this happen more, is the vulgarity. You can go into the settings when you're setting up the page. So when someone comes in and is dropping a bunch of vulgar words, it won't even show up on the page because, let's face it, it's a public page. You don't need an account to view it because it's linked right to the website, and potentially my 12-year-old could read it, and I'm sure she knows the words. I just like to live in a world where she's a perfect saint and doesn't know how to swear. But looking back, you know, the kids know that, and if they go on there and they see that, and they see that you're allowing it, well, then it must be okay. Right. The police department lets that language on there. So that's another negative. You have to really be involved with that.
That's police, essentially.
You have to, yeah. You know, I hate using that term, but you have to. You have to be able to be involved and understand that there's a give and take. I've noticed the messaging version has been used quite a lot more lately. It's been used a lot, so we've had to keep up with it. You know, it's understanding if you post something about a bad accident and you can't post anything else about how people are doing because the public understands. Well, they're not going to answer because they're on scene dealing with this. Or someone's on scene and the person that's updating it doesn't have the ability. And then when it's clear and you're able to then update it, then you do so. But you also don't leave them hanging. You have to have that relationship with them.
Thanks.
Chief, when were you most satisfied in your job?
I think when I got it? No. Most satisfied with my job. I love this line of work. It's tough to pick exactly. I loved being an officer. I loved working with the kids. It was something that I really thoroughly enjoyed. But I have to kind of, I guess, admit I really enjoyed the chief part. I'm able to affect change in some way in a community that I grew up in. I think, for the better. I think that what we're doing is tough work, obviously, but I think we've been able to build relationships. Obviously, not everybody likes law enforcement, likes police, and that's fine. You just hope that you can explain to them or show them that, you know, you're not going to judge everybody by one. So I don't think I can pick one thing about a job that I love more than the other. I mean, it tickles me a little bit that I was able to get...
So what was the biggest difference between when you were a sergeant and an appointed chief? What did you think was the biggest difference? Besides, you didn't have to work the midnight shift anymore.
Yeah, I was second shift sergeant, so I got to sleep normal Monday through Fridays and whatnot. The biggest difference, what took me by surprise, is I grew up in Barry, so I've known a lot of the select board or business owners or whatnot for almost my entire life. The biggest thing for me, when I became chief, all of a sudden people actually wanted to hear what I said and what I thought. Whereas before, it was like, hey, you're the sergeant, or you're a corporal, or hey, you're Eric. We're not going to talk, you know, we're going to go talk to your boss. Well, when you're the boss, that was kind of a weird setup for me, because it was initially, I was younger and more naive back then, and they would come to you at town meetings. Well, what does the chief think? Did you ask him yet? Is that, like, did he just say that? You know. So that was a big change for me. I think for the better. That was something that it gave you some pat on the back without actually a pat on the back. It's like, you know, you've been able to get to this position, so we value your input and your thought. And obviously, they didn't just give it to you because you're the last one left. We gave it to you because we wanted you to be there and you were qualified. So that was a big thing for me.
I try to tell people one of the things that I found working with a chief as a selectman is the level of trust that you have to have between the board and chief and town administrator. There, I don't think in my personal life, in many different positions I've had, the trust that you have to have with your chief, your town administrator, it's and especially not knowing the chief at first, but there is a tremendous amount of trust that has to be generated between people really quick sometimes.
No, that's exactly right. There's a lot of times where there's this passing of information that cannot be disseminated and it cannot be, you know, publicly announced until you have all the facts. But you know, there's many times where I've had to go to my town administrator and say, just so you know, this is going to be on the news tonight. This is what happened. And, you know, I'm giving you the version that I'm not giving the news because, you know, this is involving members of the department or members of town government or members of the public that we can't get out there. So there's a huge trust, not just professionally, but even personally. You're relying on them to support you. Yeah.
I agree. Scotty?
Chief, how do you define fair and impartial policing? See, when I read them, it's just like, when I just talk, it's easier. And sure. How would you go about ensuring a practice in your department?
Well, you know, this is another one of those buzzwords that just came up more recently than community policing. And everyone's jumping on board, and we have to look back and say, wait a minute, a lot of us have already been doing this. Fair and impartial policing has already been involved and instilled into the community. I'm sure Sunderland PD has been doing a lot of that. I'm sure neighboring towns have been doing that, but we didn't know what to call it. So what I've seen with all the stuff you can read, all the classes you attend, all the informational meetings you can go over with this, you have to be able to go back to what I said before about having, you know, the boots on the ground. The officers have to be involved with the community. And it's not because they're being paid to do it, because they want to do it. what their strengths are, how are they getting involved with the community, and having that, what's the most common, but the warrior versus guardian mindset. Not every town wants a warrior, they want a guardian. But you can't always be the guardian, sometimes you have to be the warrior. So that's that fair, or that balance that you have to do between them. You have to be able to understand that. I was just explaining before, I had a situation involving a young student at the elementary school, and the law says you need to charge this kid with this. Do you really charge someone for a mistake? This was, and I'm not saying just cast a big broad brush and say, okay, you all are absolved of everything.
Sure.
But this was a young child that, whoops, and I'm going to go and charge this kid with a felony, and then they're never going to be able to have a job ever, because what employee is going to see this? So you look at that and you say, well, what can we do that this child understands what was right, what was wrong? What kind of punishment is that person getting from the parents, from the school? And will that hold more water than bringing him into a courtroom he has no idea anything about, and then listening to a judge yell at him or her, and then go on from there? So I give you that as a experience that I had recently, because I think that kind of encompasses a fair and partial. You're not sitting there saying it's black and white. There's a lot of gray. I know we drive black and whites, but there's a lot of gray, and you have to be able to figure out between the two, but then get the community involved, and they understand why you're doing what you're doing. You're not letting Johnny's brother off because he's Johnny's brother. You're not hammering, Bobby's sister because she's not from town, so you have to, you're not doing that. There's a case-by-case situation where you have to look at it and understand that it's not all black and white, and you have to be able to have that trust with the community and the involvement where they understand that you're taking their best interest to mind when you're doing investigations, when you're doing community involvement. So that's how I break it down.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
What next steps would you explore as a police chief for doing regional, not regionalization in the terms of, that's kind of talking about buzzwords, that's a big buzzword at the state level, but more like regional cooperation, not so much regionalization in the sense that we've been talking about a lot around here.
So the cooperation is key. If we're not going to get funding to have more from the state or from the feds, and we're strapped as a community, you have to rely on your sister and brother departments, but not just the police departments. In being with Central Mass Chiefs, we involved with all the communities about doing a memorandum of understanding and an agreement between each department. Now, one could say, well, that agreement says that if I'm in Barrie and I have to go to Bellingham to pick up a prisoner, and I see someone run a red light, I can stop them and issue a ticket. He or she would be a fool for doing it. I mean, would the law probably allow him because of that agreement? You're splitting hairs. The agreement is really there to have the luxury of calling in. So we rely heavily on Hardwick, Oakham, Petersham, all these towns around us, as they rely on us. So you don't want someone's defense to be, well, Barrie officer or Sunderland officer didn't arrest me, Deerfield officer arrested me. Well, the Deerfield officer arrested you because he or she was being called in to assist for that mutual aid, and therefore that extension of authority was granted to them. So that's the law enforcement aspect of it. But you have to have a relationship with other communities and other services. You have a major incident, can you handle a search through the wooded area because of a lost hiker or something? Are you going to have to rely on your fire and EMS? I know you have a regional EMS.
EMS.
So you're going to rely on them, you're going to rely on the fire, or are you going to reach out to Deerfield or Greenfield or state police? You have to have that relationship and build on that, and that's something we've been doing, and I know a lot of other police departments, especially on this area too, rely heavily on that. That being said, you also then have to have a cooperation with the community. I'm part of our local Project Purple, that's the pin I have, and it's also a group we called Q-Drug. Try to think of fancy buzzword names, couldn't figure anything out, so we took the school name, Quabbin, and then made it into an acronym, so Quabbin Drug Unifying Group. And basically what that group is we took the regional high school, the five towns, and any of the other towns that wanted to jump on and say, listen, we've been hit with this opioid epidemic, and we need to instruct, we need to educate, and we need to have everyone understand that this is not going away quickly, and we need to have parents' involvement, their buy-in, legislatures, town government officials like yourself, local police and fire chiefs, ambulance people, and you have to have that involvement. Some people jump on board because it's tugging on your heartstrings. It's involved, someone in your family's involved with it, someone you know has lost a life. But then some people are just curious and want to know what this is about. So we've been involved in this group, and we've done a lot. I like to think that they've done a lot. I'm just along because I'm the resident police chief, but they've done an amazing job. They've brought courses, they've brought groups to the community. We've had a lot of Barry people show up. We don't have a lot of involvement from the other towns, because I think in the beginning they thought, this is just a Barry group. Like, no, you can come. And that was one of the things we had it was an eye-opener. We realized we weren't getting the word out to enough people in the neighboring towns. So we started coming up, they started to come up with some crazy ideas and painting the town purple. No vandalism, just, you know, taking photos of stuff and then photoshopping it with purple stuff on it. The lawn signs for elections that people buy, to re-elect, you know, yourself, they'll give up a couple of them and they'll spray paint them purple and they'll stick them on the lawn to show. So things like that, and it got the eye of people, and it built a lot of relationships with people that we never thought we would have. And so you need to do that and get involved and within the communities and then reach out beyond that. Okay?
Yeah, thanks.
Chief, talk about your financial skills and experience, and what areas would you look at to stretch the PD budget in a small town? And how would you approach that challenge? Probably you've never, in a wealthy town like Barry, you've never had that problem, have you?
I wouldn't call us wealthy. That's a common occurrence, no matter, I think, if you're Brookline, Barry, or Sunderland, I mean, or a smaller town. You're going to have restraints. I was blessed with a sergeant that loved cars. Loved him. He was really finicky on making sure the guys and girls washed their cars whenever they could, waxed them, vacuumed them so that's not a mud hole, and took pride in the vehicle. So as we did that, people said, wow, your cruisers are looking nice, they look wonderful. Why do you need more money for a new car? The cars look great. So then it kind of backfired because we had these beautiful looking cars, and I keep telling them, well, they've got 150,000 miles on them, and the warranty has been gone for 60,000-70,000, and an engine costs this and this costs that. So we started looking into, I didn't preface this, the biggest thing for us obviously are capital expenses. That's a huge thing. We started looking into revolving accounts. Instead of trying to get money to raise and appropriate every year, saying, okay, we need 40 grand for a cruiser. All right, well, what about a revolving account? Is there something that we can put in place that, for instance, road jobs and details? You can't have that in one specific account for road jobs and details, because when the company pays, the officer gets paid, it goes back to zero. There shouldn't be $1,200 in that account. There shouldn't be $5,000 in that account. So the understanding was, all right, well, there's some wear and tear with the cruisers being used because they're on a road job doing something. So then we started incorporating a I don't want to use the word tax because that's horrible, a fee for a cruiser. And that, something small that companies would pay for, something like National Grid or electric companies, to AT&T, Verizon, Charter, those companies would be paying, especially if they requested a cruiser. You're in a bad intersection, you need to have something. And it was, I think it was $50. It started small. And then over time, and we've had some projects in town where we're spending, not spending, but we're billing out $20,000, $25,000 worth of details because MassDOT came in and just decided to do a beautification of 122, and they're just starting in Ocam and working their way to Petersham. So you might not get that money from MassDOT, but there's other companies that you get that money from. That money that was extra, whether it be an admin fee or the fee, that would go into the revolving account. And it was the understanding that excess above and beyond the budget. You have an operating budget, you know you got to buy tires, you know you have to get the cars inspected, you have to do oil changes, but, oh no, a tie rod breaks, or a radiator cracks, and you have to replace it. You know, where are we going to come up with $500? Well, let's look in the account. What's in that account? Oh, you've got $900. Well, great. Let's spend it through there. Now, in my town, there was the Selectman had a provision about spending a certain amount of money, and if you were to go over that threshold, you had to sit down with them because they didn't want you just arbitrarily paying out of that account, paying out of this account. I don't know if you guys have that here, but other than regular procurement law, it was something different. And so if it got up to a certain threshold, you'd sit down with them and say, you know, this is what I have. Even if it was something as simple as writing a letter or an email and say, this is what I have. And if they wanted it, if it could wait to one of their meetings, they would wait. If not, and they said, this is an expense, you're going to get paid, you know, we're going to have this done, go ahead. So you have to think outside the box of things like that with capital expenses of that nature. But then expand on capital expenses, replacing cruisers, replacing fire trucks, replacing ambulances. They're not cheap. I mean, the fire chief bought 4 new tires, and I think it cost $1,200. And I'm
just one payloader tire.
Exactly. And that's...
No, we know.
One.
Oh, my.
One tire.
One.
You know, used, and it's slightly used. It's,
I'm lucky if a set of 4 tires on a cruiser costs less than $500. And here I am looking at you, and you're going to buy $1,200 for... that's
now,
why
do you use the state bid on the tires?
Yes. Yeah.
That's a great deal, isn't it?
Sometimes. but you have to get the pursuit rated. You have to have, because God forbid there's an accident, the first thing they're going to say was, well, you put on, you know, and I hope I'm not using someone's name, you know, you put on Jimmy's tires. You're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to use these tires.
Jimmy, the number is 6.
Yeah, yeah. You can be reached at. So you've got to look into that and figuring out, well, what has worked so far. Do we have issues with overspending within the police department, and why? Is it on the personnel side? Is it on the salary, or is it on the expense side? One thing that we found most recently was I had, just for court, I had an $8,400 budget for the year. And we had a very busy year prior to that with drunk driving arrests. My officers, one officer in particular, had more drunk driving arrests than the entire department did 2 years prior. So he, not him personally, but you know what I'm saying, he arrested me. So people get that wrong. They think that I meant that he got locked up. That's not what I'm saying. And that's great. He was doing that. He was getting involved. But then the following year, what came up on the court cases? What are a lot of people doing? And I can understand why they're doing it. They're postponing them. So the officer goes in, the officer's getting paid 2, 3, 4 hours, straight time, overtime, whatever it is, part-time, full-time, whatever you have. And then that, instead of them going in averaging the department 20 hours a month, now we're averaging 48 hours a month. So I had to go to the finance committee in the end of December and said, I'm about 2 days from spending out of my overtime for court. It ran away. It just continued. So we looked back and we saw the summonses, and we keep the summonses when the officers get them. And I went through and was able to removed the name, so the finance committee didn't see that information. Some of it involved juvenile, some of it involved domestic violence. So I looked at it and said, well, this is it. This officer has been summoned to court four times in 2 months or 3 months, where normally he'd be there four times in a year. So we started seeing a trend. So we had, at that point, there was nothing we could do. At that point, we had to go to the town and say, we're on track to go in the red on this. And then we had to look at, was there any other ways to spend around that? Did we have something that occurred that normally doesn't occur? Did we have something that normally occurs that didn't happen this year that we can take the money from on the police side and try to stay within the budget? We were able to make it work, but it was an eye-opener. It was a quick, all of a sudden, wow, what happened? And then I've noticed this trend, and I've had to increase the line item for court because the officers, if they don't go, then what are they doing? You're paying them to work. They're doing their work, and then they have to go to court to uphold and defend further down the line, and then they don't go. Well, now you've paid them to really do nothing and waste your time. It's kind of the final finish the product and where they're going to go from there. So it was an eye-opener.
We actually talked to the DA's office about that. Mm-hmm. And the DA, our DA, David Sullivan, has worked very hard with our past chief and other chiefs, because that was a common thread for many towns, was just that, especially our small town. He did a nice job for us.
Good. And that's good. We had a cut down on... you get the call in, you go there, you're there 5 minutes, and he goes, oh, we're not going to need you today, see you later.
Right.
And of course, the officer's like, sweet, and they go leave, but when they get to the station and they see me, and they said, hi, Chief, you left here 45 minutes ago, and it takes 20 minutes to get to court, and then 20 minutes to get back. Did you forget something? No, he released me. No, not anymore. So we did the same thing. We called the ADA and said, if you know you're not going to have them, you tell us the day before so we can cancel them.
Right.
Because all you're doing is depleting my budget.
Right.
So that in that aspect it worked out. But he couldn't really help me on, well, the defense attorney postponed it to another date, you know. But we've worked with the DAs. We have a great relationship with the courthouse. We're kind of stuck in between two. We have Western Worcester District Court, which is East Brookfield, and then we have Juvenile Court, which is in Worcester. So we have to travel to both courts, which is interesting because juvenile court is attached to adult court, but we use this one. So instead of having everything under one roof, we have them under two. But at least I'm not like, say, a neighboring town of mine who's got to use Fitchburg and Gardner.
Yeah,
or,
right.
You know, it's two opposite, very far away directions. So I'm thankful I don't have to do that.
Thank you,
Chief. Follow up on the financial. As a department head, do you develop the budget, or is there a finance director?
No, I developed the budget. It was a very big eye opener back when I first started doing the budget 9.5 years ago, almost 10. We do have a finance committee,
sure.
So I was able to sit down with them and go over. The great thing about that, when I learned from some of the initial chief courses that they had, and then sitting down with the finance committee. Like I told you before, I can talk a dog off a meat wagon. They don't want to hear, or they didn't then, they didn't want to hear every specific line. They said, where are you going up and tell us why?
Right.
And that was great because I had prepared, this is what I think we're going to need to talk about. But they're an advisory committee. So they feel like, yeah, we support you. We think that's great, but we don't make the vote. It's the board. So we have to go bring you to the Board of Selectmen.
Interesting.
Hopefully I'm not introducing anything new to town that people...
No. He actually left. He was a finance committee member.
Oh, some finance committees are... Depends on the history of a town. Some are much more...
authoritative than... No?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just wanted to work.
I had a great relationship with them, and it's you bring them the information, explain why you see an increase... some of the increases we've had recently in my town were due to salary, union negotiations. Yep. Full-timers had unions. So.
I could, Mr. Chair. Question 11 here, Chief, has got what impacts on small towns and regional policing do you see with some of the new technology pressures that we have?
A lot of national discussion about body cameras, drones, helmet cams. I'm exaggerating, but I'm stretching too. So,
well, whether it be Sunderland, whether it be Barry, whether it be Worcester, whether it be Northampton, Greenfield, the criminal and the citizen are going to have far better technology than you as a police officer.
Sure.
They have private funds, or they steal, and we have public funds, and we're restricted by what we can have. There are, when I first started in Barry, we had cameras in the cruisers. And I remember being trained by the what they called an FTO, but after being chief for 9.5 years, I realized they were not the FTO. But, you know, and their biggest thing was, oh, this thing, you know, this, you're going to hate this thing. But it's all I ever knew when I first started.
Sure.
You get in, you put the blue lights on, the camera starts. You get up to the car, before you get to the car, you turn on the audio, and you're able to explain to the operator that you've got an audio and video recording. And so much has changed in that. The next question now is, well, body cameras. You know, to put a camera in a cruiser, it's about $5,000. If you have five cruisers, do you have $25,000 to $35,000 to spend right now to install the cruisers? And then if you want to go and take the human aspect out, add another $10,000 to that and put in a Wi-Fi router in the station so when you pull in, it downloads automatically. Therefore, no one's misusing or playing with it or screwing it up. Body cameras. There are so many programs out there. The most recent one that I looked into was the Taser Axon body camera. They have the sunglasses, they have the headgear, and they have the one that you wear. To do a program that they had in mind was a charging docking station that would hold up to, I think, 8 or 12 devices. And you would take it, you put it in the docking station, someone else would come in for their shift and take another one. While this is charging, it's also downloading to the system. A lot of cloud-based information. The biggest issue I see is the unknowns regarding public records law. I don't know if your town has ever been not plagued, but has ever been involved with somebody who always asks for public records?
Not in our town, but it has been a very hot spot or hot topic in other towns that have had that same problem. And essentially, people taking advantage of the public records law. We actually had a whole topic as regional selectmen about that, taking advantage of it for what it's clearly not intended
exactly.
to do.
So you can still be open and honest and have a transparent form of government and then incorporate that if you end up having body cameras. But the public has to understand that, well, when is it public, when is it not? And then if the state legislature or the federal government deems that it's all public, well, then there's some questions because there are police reports I can't give out because of juveniles. There's police reports I can't give out because of domestic violence. I don't want to re-victimize those involved. So then I'm supposed to go through and watch that video. Well, I have someone else watch that video and figure out what part can be taken out. And then when I take it out, I have to explain in writing under public records law why it's being taken out.
Yeah.
So I went from, here you go, this is the video, to, oh, well, I have to go through that. Well, now that's something extra. So there's a lot of things. And these body cameras now, the minute you clip it to your uniform, it's on all the time. And it's doing that recording where it's not really recording, but it's recording. So when something happens and you push that button, it says, oh, something's happening, and it goes back 30 seconds and captures. Well, you have to have a lot of policies in place because what if that officer just finished using the bathroom? What if that officer was just at a domestic and he gets into the cruiser and then now you get a call, you press that button, or someone interacts with you and you press that button. What about that first 30 seconds? You know, so you have to have policies in place about when to activate it, how to set it up, what laws, you know, are you going to fully follow with either the public records or and what involvement is the town going to have as far as funding that? When I looked into it for Barry, this is now through 2 or 3 years ago, year one I think was $22,000, and that was only six cameras, a docking station, and then cloud-based system.
Storage. A lot of data storage.
It's going to be huge. I recently bought a 3 terabyte hard drive to be separate from any computers and from online hacks for all my booking videos. So the booking video gets captured, it gets saved on that device, we back it up, and then we can store that somewhere else. So that 3 terabyte hard drive is great because it'll, once it's filled, I can then take it, store it somewhere else, and if they say, hey, you booked the guy in 2012, do you have that video? Go downstairs, take out this little device that's this big, instead of my 15 file boxes, and go 2011, 2012. So I'm saving space, I'm saving the ability to then go after that. Now, what if it gets damaged? What if it gets destroyed? What if it gets corrupt, viruses? You have to explain that under the public records law. And that is an ever-changing law. They're coming up with different things and how to change with that. So, and I'm sorry if I've gone roundabout from your question,
no,
but when you look at that type of technology, you have to look at the laws and how it's going to affect the town and the public. You want to be able to have the openness and show the town that you're doing it, and then you can use it for whatever reasons, but you then also have to follow the law because you don't want to violate someone else's rights.
Thank you. Actually, it was a good lesson in how complex the issues actually are.
It was sort of a follow back to sort of the some of the earlier topics. What's the appropriate role and responsibility of a local police department in keeping schools and students and staff safe? And you've kind of touched on that earlier, and also just sort of keep in mind too that we do have there is a resource officer in the regional school that's paid for by the town that it's in. So there is, you do have that.
So the officer's paid for by, is it Deerfield?
Deerfield, yeah.
Solely by Deerfield? You guys don't have a percentage?
No, not that I'm aware of.
Outstanding. How did you do that? And can you let me know?
I have to talk to Deerfield about
okay,
that.
Okay, I'll ask Joe about it. That's amazing. Yet you have to have the involvement with the staff, and then you have to go over the safety and the security. I've been involved in every year since becoming chief in 2006, a training regiment with local officers and state police. It's what they call an active shooter. That program, we get involved with the officers. Like I said, we've had it at least once every year. We've had some grants. Sometimes we've picked it up through our own budget. One grant in particular that sticks out in my head, I think, was 2011. I was able to get a regional grant from Homeland Security for $75,000. We had over 105 players. We had school, local police, state police, EMS, fire. We waited till the week of Christmas when there was no school, and we figured most people would be out of town, and we shut down the second busiest road in town for about 7 hours. Made a lot of happy people that day.
I bet.
But the you have to have the training. The officers have to go through this training. If they could do it twice a year, I'd recommend twice a year. The great thing about it is it teaches them the school, because a lot of times, even in my own department, I'll have part-time officers who will work a couple of times a month, who I'll walk them, they end up taking a random day shift with me, and we'll go into the school, and they're looking around, and so what's the matter? So I'm a little lost. How are you lost?
It's the school.
You've been on the department for 4 years. You know, I don't come up here very much. I said, well, what about the alarm calls? Yeah, well, you know, we come in, the guy says it's probably this, and we leave. I said, you have to go through, you have to familiarize yourself with the school. Then you get the staff involved. And I don't know what the training is involved with the school here. I don't know if they follow the Alice mentality or the lockdown, the Homeland Security lockdown and shelter in place type mentality. I'm not sure what the school district wants, but great points in both. So I don't think one is better than the other. I think if you take something from both of them, it's great, because as a dad, I don't want to teach my now she's 12, but when she was in kindergarten, I didn't want to teach her how to fight an attacker. But if you have a senior class on the football team,
different story.
Have fun. You know, maybe that's something that they might be involved with more. But even if it's just mostly awareness, that's the big, big, big thing. Schools are a learning environment. They're not made to look like jail cells or have bars in the windows and have concrete walls throughout. They may have concrete walls because it was cheaper to build it, but there's windows. It lets in light. Windows don't stop attackers, but you don't want it to be a negative space where that's all they think of is like a jail. Because for the most part, schools are very safe. But involve the staff, involve the, and then determining on the age level and age-appropriate classes. We've held them in my elementary school. We've held them in my junior, senior high school, and explained shelter in place, explained lockdown, and you have that as a program. And what you try to do is have it almost as many times as you have a fire drill. What do you have, like 3 or 4 fire drills a year? Well, why don't you have a shelter in place drill? Get the kids used to it, so when it happens, they're not freaking out saying, there must be something horrible because we've never done this. Or, on the opposite end, they go and do something because you call a lockdown or you call whatever the terminology is, and they've never done this before and they're so disorganized, they're giving up their location to the suspect. So you want to be able to get that and have it involved with everybody. So you have to do it. It's just something that, unfortunately, it's today's environment. I would love to look back 50 years from now and say, wow, that was the biggest waste of our time. I would love to say that, as long as I don't look back 50 years from now and say, we missed Johnny, or we missed Sarah, we missed, you know, I would hate to do that.
Thank you, Chief.
Thanks.
Now, this is almost the final question. Chief, can you describe failure?
Failure would be proof that you tried something and didn't succeed. If you don't know failure, then you've never applied yourself to see yourself not attain that goal. Failure should also be a driving force to get you and motivate you to do better.
What in this role would you consider success as a chief?
Going home at the end of the day, being able to know that you and your staff and your civilian citizens went home safely. Officer wellness is a big thing. Resident wellness is a big thing. They want to be able to trust you. They want to be able to believe in you, and then same thing with the staff. So as long as you can go home every day, same amount of fingers and toes you came in with, the same mindset, that's a success every day. And you take the little ones every day.
Chief, do you consider yourself a tactical or a strategic person?
I would like to think I'm a little bit of both, but
this is the first time I've heard you take a pause, Chief. You know.
I'm surprised I've been able to breathe the whole time. I'm probably more towards strategic.
Scott, you want to ask the last question?
I would, Mr. Chair. So, after all of this, what do you have questions for us?
How late do you want to stay? No. from what I understand, that your chief was retiring.
Has retired.
Has retired, I'm sorry. Has retired. And you're looking to replace the position. What are you looking for from that new chief? Are you looking, what's the top things that you can think of that you want that chief to encompass, that chief to be and bring to the table?
Sure. If I can take the first crack, Mr. Chair?
Good question.
I would say that the best parts of the existing staff, both in policy, personnel, and practices, are a platform for a new chief to bring his or her experience to add on to that, to recognize where there is an area for opportunity and to execute that opportunity with a deft hand. We've got a maturing community by demographic, and a substantial component of our community is shorter time residents. It's an interesting blend. I say that because we actually have the second highest concentration of rental units in the Commonwealth, second only to the city of Boston. So we have not necessarily, and you know, we think about, there is a common misperception that the rental units turn over at a great frequency. Mm. We actually don't have that kind of frequency. There's a bit of a misconception. There is the individuals who live in those apartments, rental units, South and North Main Street, one and two family dwellings, are as much a part of our community as someone who's third generation, right? So I would say that chief has an interesting opportunity to bring their collective experience and build on our existing successes. And not every success is that. That's really important. Success can also breed comfort.
Okay.
David? I think one of the things I'm looking for, too, is a more proactive approach to the job, I think, than reactive. And then also kind of grappling with a lot of the changes. I think there's a lot of changes, as you know, over the last, say 5-10 years. And I think there's going to be, with some of the technological changes, even more changes coming along. And yet some of the core of the job still remains. It gets affected by these other things. But in the end, the core reason you're there hasn't changed. Sure. So I think, somebody to keep that in mind, I think, is very important. And especially with the outreach, because like Scott said, we are an aging demographic, but now we're also the one town with actually growing families again, too. I think because you're starting to see some shift, too, whereas we're aging, you're starting to see some people moving out, being replaced by newer families. So there's a little shift in that, too. So it's a lot of balance of a wide range of demographics in that respect. So
good.
The Board of Selectmen makes three appointments that are probably define a board. Mm-hmm. Town administrator, chief of police, highway superintendent. School committee appoints the principal / superintendent. They make that. Those four positions are the face of the community. That's how we are all judged. The question earlier about the tactical or strategic, I think it's important that our because we are a small town, I would hope our chief is a resource for our officers, that they can come to the chief and say, "Chief, what do we do when this or that or whatever?" Chief doesn't, and that can take on a lot of different things, not necessarily that the chief has to have that answer at the top of his head, but he has the knowledge of where to go to get that answer. I would want to see the chief motivate our officers and pass along his passion for the job. Great opportunity for the new chief to come in. He sees things a little bit differently. I love the fact when I see an officer, the cruiser stop, and he's out talking to people on the sidewalks. I love to see, I remember in one of our central Mass towns, I think it was in Townsend, the chief, I was working a job up in that area, and every morning I saw the chief would come up, pull his car over, walk around the common, and go into the all the little different places and just let people know. Chief of police makes a difference in our community. Absolutely. I'd love to see the chief be involved with our district attorney's office, with the state police, with our other departments that surround us, because if something happens, I think it's very important to pass the information that you have to those other areas law enforcement branches as quick as possible, early in the process. Mm-hmm. I think it's important for the chief to know those. I don't think the chief should be meeting the district attorney for the first time in a court on some kind of case. I think they should have a relationship. And like I said before, I think the chief has to be someone that we feel comfortable with, the town administrator feels comfortable with, that we can talk to one another. I'm probably not going to always agree with the chief. The chief is probably not going to always agree with us. But we can have those conversations. And maybe the answer is not our way of thinking or the chief's way of thinking. It's someplace in the middle. I think that's what I'm looking for, chief.
Great. The only other question I had about the position was, do you prefer, and this is weird for me because I grew up in Barry, and I've always, I went away and I came back and military and whatnot, but do you prefer your chief to live in the community, or are you okay with the chief living in a neighboring community, like a town touching the community? I know there's a restriction saying that they have to be, the law is 15 miles, some towns prefer 10, some towns even go as far as saying they want you to be 10 miles from the station, but...
You know, chief, the great thing being a selectman is you understand that sometimes everything's not fair.
Yeah.
Meaning in the job of a police officer, you may have to do something that may not be popular, and especially if you have children and they're going to the local schools. We understand that. We're not saying that you have to live in the community. Nice if you live in a nearby community. But if the whoever we choose as a chief thinks it's best not to live in the community because he has children or spouse that doesn't, it can be hard. It can be hard. So we wouldn't say you have to live in the town of Sunderland. That's not what we're trying to do.
And that's fair. I only ask because, like I said, I grew up in Barry, and that's all I know.
Sure.
I know that I live in the town that I work for. So I see the good and the bad, on duty, off duty.
And we do too. Right. And we've had chiefs that have lived in town. We've had chiefs chiefs that have been very involved with our community. We have chiefs that it's been a job for them, that may not been as involved as we would have liked or the town would have liked. But I would say that's kind of a personal decision. And I don't think we would, I don't think our board right now, we would never tell you that you have to live in the center of Sunderland, anywhere from 340 North Main Street to 340 South Main Street. We wouldn't tell you that. We could even allow you to go live up by Gary Breer.
All the way up there.
Way in the outskirts.
Because he does live in South Montague. So.
South Montague.
So I don't think we'd tell you that. I don't think we'd tell you one way. I think that in the area, that's fine. And because there's an expectation that you understand that you're a full-time. I don't think a chief, very, very rare to find a part-time, full-time, un-full-time chief. They're full-time positions.
Exactly. Okay. No, thank you. I think that's really the two main ones, other than, keeping you here late. I think those are the two main ones I had questions about.
So what we plan on doing now, is we have one more interview. Typically, our board in the past have let a few days go by so we can recycle the things, and we'll probably start talking next week. And hopefully, I would say in the next couple weeks, we should be in a position. At that point, we'll take a vote. At that time, we would typically We do have a contract with our chiefs, and we don't have to have contracts, but it is allowed, and it is allowed under the 108.0N or whatever that
is. Yeah, the employment law.
Yeah, the employment law. So, we kind of use the contract as a doctrine that we base our relationship under.
Sure.
It's good for the chief. It's good for us.
And that reminds me of my other question I should have asked, and I apologize if I may.
Oh, go ahead.
Is the position of chief of police here a strong chief or?
Yes.
It is. Okay.
That was easy.
That was easy.
Yeah. It's interesting. It's interesting. The laws that govern chiefs. We do have a strong chief of police, and we do have a strong chief of fire.
And strong fire chiefs are usually a lot higher up in the strength department compared to a police chief.
Absolutely.
I believe the fire chiefs have absolute power, which is amazing that they have that.
They appoint their sole appointment authority, and the law is totally different from one to the next. So
yeah, definitely.
But I would like to thank you. There's stuff that we learned just by talking to you.
Great. Well, I thank you very much for your time and letting me get at least to this level of the process. I've really enjoyed my visits out here just to kind of snoop and spy to see what it's like, and it's a beautiful community, so I thank you very much.
Thank you. We appreciate your interest.
Thank you, Chief.